Be able to keep the energy of Michael Nyman going, so I'm gonna play some Teddy Bear Picnic in the background. Peter Greenaway, in his prime, especially in his films working with Sasha Vierny, has created the most painterly films humanly possible. Not only that every frame looks like a painting or the brilliant use of lighting, but through how Greenaway uses every chance he gets to morph his visuals to tell the story. I believe that his film A Zed and Two Noughts demonstrates this perfectly. Not that his other films don't, but Zed absolutely just screams this at the audience. I created the intro firstly to emphasize the way Alba's room morphs throughout the film. His scene, when you put all the scenes together, it looks like just five back-to-back incredible match cuts. That he subtly changes everything in the room. The paint on the walls, the curtains covering the windows, what's on the bed, the color and amount of light that fills the room, but most interestingly is what he uses to source the light.
We actually, I suppose, played, I suppose, and hope serious games about the notion of light, about its source and how it works, and we actually sat down and made a list of 26 different ways we could light a set, and if you look at the film very carefully, you can work out what those 26 different ways are.
In this way, the feeling of the scene can be sensed without words or gestures. But the contrast in his visuals has a lasting effect, like jumping from some of the most beautifully crafted scenes filled with intricately built sets, beautiful people, fancy dazzling clothes, to animals decomposing and doctors performing amputations that he isn't afraid to.
But I'm going to make sure, if you don't agree with my subject matter, if you're bored by my philosophizing, you're going to be wowed by the pictures.
And he's never let me down with his visuals, but while there's a contrast in the subject matter, there isn't in the way he films them. While he may be filming the decomposition of a being, he deliberately films the death in an aesthetic fashion, such as the fish, which are slowly being turned to bone, placed together almost as if they're kissing, giving symmetry to a chaotic scene, and that you cannot have life without death. He treats death with the same respect as life. While he respects the death of the animal enough that he would want to record the decomposition, these scenes don't feel natural, even though a natural process is occurring. As the animal carcasses are placed on a photography setting, placed on a grid marked cloth, that even the most natural, destined to occur phenomenon can feel as artificial as his lighting or set design. This film has a complex narrative, as it feels more like multiple films crunched in together, which I don't want to cover in whole. Instead, I want to focus on some of the symbolism which appears throughout the film that I found interesting, starting with the use of symmetry. I'm not talking purely about Greenaway's obsession with having symmetric shots, but Alba's obsession with symmetry, that she loses one of her legs in a car crash. Now having only one leg, she starts believing that her single leg is dying of loneliness, that they were meant to be a pair, soulmates attached till death. In the film, symmetry is seen as life, which its opposite, death, being represented by decomposition, which is the process that destroys symmetry, that decays the process of slowly eroding the symmetry of the being, that life is created in symmetry, and losing this is slowly coming closer to your death. This ties in with Alba's leg, that her loss of physical symmetry leads her to have an almost existential break. But it's not only the legs, but also two twin brothers that she entangles with, falling in love with the men at the same time, almost as if she traded her legs to find another form of symmetry in her life to cling to. But these twins are Siamese in a sense. They share the same personality, scars, sexuality, ambitions. They're completely the same in every sense, as if they're the exact same person, but they choose not to reveal this information to anybody except for Alba. there's a scene where the brothers speak with Alba about their secrecy, which is where the main story really starts to take shape, that they don't want people to gawk at them as if there's some oddity or freak show, but that others like them, now civilized, are kept in zoos, but they're a rare species that inhabits a zoo. But while they believe they are keeping this secret, they can be seen jogging in a conjoined set of running wear and a conjoined suit they wear later in the film. They're truly animals living in a zoo, and I'm not talking about the zoo hypothesis of the Fermi paradox, that human life hasn't been touched by extraterrestrial life because they look at Earth as a human zoo. There's an incredible article written by this person, I can't pronounce her name, so I'm gonna put it on the screen. She wrote an article called The Exploitation of Human Nature and Non-Human Nature in Peter Greenaway's A Zed Two Noughts. She makes this connection in the scene where Oliver is inside the cage next to the tiger cage in the surgery room of Van Meegeren. While they have an entire audience watching the moment, Oliver passes the cage like the tiger. He empathizes with the tiger's plight while those in the crowd shout about taking its life, that he won't let the tiger out of the cage out of fear that it'll be shot. He strips in the cage, which I see as him pitying the tiger. But following the scene is the brothers meeting with the surgeon Van Meegeren. In the same way that the zoo animals are confined, given surgery so they exist longer, in the same way the brothers are animals thrown through this surgical slaughterhouse, as the doctors try to convince the brothers into conjoining their bodies alike Alba was convinced to amputate her second leg. How they exist in this zoo of animals, but there's a zoo of people living in this ecosystem of oddities and rarities. In the same way that freak shows exist, this imagined zoo has a surgical freak show built around it. In the way that these animals are kept for their value determined by humans, the people of the story also attach value to themselves based on their rarity in the eyes of others. In the same way that the animal's rarity determined their corpse's value when the brothers attempted to procure them to film. At the final scene, they acknowledge their rarity and relatedness to the animals when they decide to off themselves for the purpose of filming their decay. I feel like the ending with the snails represents this larger connection between life and death, that their project was befuddled by the snails which covered the camera and cut the power, that they gave their life to finish this project, their grand finale, killing themselves in the least natural form, injecting themselves while lying on a photography scene. But once dead, the natural process of decomposition strips the scene of artificiality as the nature around the stage starts to encroach, that at the end of the day, we are animals living in this natural system, that we can attempt to remove ourselves from nature through the progress of society, but nature always catches up, that they are no different than any other animal they filmed. I feel like the main message Greenaway wanted to install in the viewer is that humans can't deny their nature, that life and death are the only inevitabilities, that humans act as gods, stripping away animals from their environment, locking them in cages, determining who lives or dies through surgical intervention, that humans perform the same to themselves, building small containers to abide in, controlling who gets medical intervention through financing, which leads to humans playing God, determining who lives or dies. In all, I don't think that Greenaway would have found his way to making some of his later films without the experiment of A Zed and Two Noughts, the use of Sasha Vierny, his unique variable lighting, set and costume design, that he truly found his style through the making of this film. While this is definitely one of Greenaway's least accessible films, that it doesn't follow a specific genre or it has multiple storylines, I think that this film truly shows his intentions, that he wants to talk about two inevitabilities, sex and death, that he wants to tell the story through visuals over dialogue, and he's not afraid to discuss the audience to get this message across.